Good morning. Would you please stand and sing with us our call to worship? Come, now is the time to worship. 2, 3.
Now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before. You are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give.
Isn't it great to be in God's house today? Today is the second Sunday of Lent. Lent is a season of returning to the Lord, and it is a season of repentance, a time for our hearts and our minds to be changed. And so it's great to come here with open hearts, with open minds, asking God to turn us back to Him and to have His way and to change us into the image and likeness of His Son. How many of y'all have an open heart for God to do something special in you today? All right, let's go to Him in prayer. Father, we do open our hearts to You. We open our minds to You. May we be wholly Yours. This is Your hour. And we pray, Father, that as we give ourselves to Your Lordship, as we open ourselves to Your love, that You would become Lord of all, every part of our lives, and that You would make us into Your heart. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Please take a moment to greet those around you as we pass the peace of Christ.
Thank you. You may be seated as we continue. We're doing two slow ones today. Yes, sir. All right.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Born of all creation. Water, earth, and sky. universe declares your majesty. You are holy. Thank you.
Hope everybody got a bulletin when you came in. Anybody notice anything different? It's bigger, yeah. So we've gone back to a trifold a number of years ago. Our church for longest time had a trifold, and our space has been kind of cramped. So now we have more of the service in your bulletin. We have a whole page for prayer concerns, and then we have a separate page for announcements. And you've got a little spot, if you want, a whole back page where you can make notes. I used to make notes on the front, and that was messy. So if you want to make sermon notes or you want to make your grocery list, whatever you want to do, okay? That's right there for you. Okay, and we're working on that. But we appreciate your thoughts and reflections as we're improving that. Also, want to remind you to use that little portion at the bottom of the panel about announcements to let us know if you're going to be with us for Wednesday night. You can mark that, tear it off, stick it in the bulletin. You can call the church office or put it in the offering plate, or you can call the church office. Let us know that you're going to be here for supper on Wednesday. It's great for us to know how many folks are going to come so we can prepare. Oh, corned beef and cabbage. Mashed potatoes. Doesn't that sound good? I love corned beef and cabbage. That's great. You'll want to join us this Wednesday for supper. And I've been doing a Bible study series on 1 Corinthians. We just finished chapter 6. We'll be talking about 1 Corinthians chapter 7 this coming Wednesday. And our children will have children's activities. The youth have just started a new series. We're talking about the seven deadly sins and the corresponding seven cardinal virtues. We just started that this past Wednesday. And so invite our teenagers to be with us for our series on the seven deadly sins and the seven cardinal virtues Wednesday nights. Also, our youth need to remember that tonight is our movie night. And so we'll have a movie night at 6 o'clock tonight in the youth room. And bring a friend. We'll have a great time and we'll have snacks and a good time of fellowship. Our United Methodist women have a call to prayer and self-denial this Wednesday at 10 o'clock in the morning. That'll be at the youth room, youth building. And also It's announced in your bulletin that we're going to have a worship committee meeting at 11 o'clock. And because we have a meeting afterwards, we're going to pull that back. We made an executive decision this morning, didn't we, Susan, to pull that back to 10:30. So if you're on the worship committee, we want to make sure we have plenty of time for preparations for the rest of Lent and Holy Week. It's a busy, busy time of discipleship. And so very quickly, I want to share with you what's coming up, okay? We at our church have a spring stewardship emphasis. And so for the rest of Lent, beginning next week, we'll be talking about stewardship. And we are using a little book called Enough. Enough. Isn't that a great idea? It's such a weird idea to think that we could have enough. But this is by Adam Hamilton, Enough, Discovering Joy Through Simplicity and Generosity. And so if you haven't picked up this book already, you can order this online or you can call the church office. We'll order one for you. It's not too late to get started. Our Sunday school classes are going to be working through the introduction of this book today. And then we'll have 4 weeks where we'll have a stewardship emphasis for Lent on learning joy through simplicity and generosity. We'll say more about that in a bit, but I believe that how we approach money is not a money issue. It's a spiritual issue. It's a spiritual issue. And God wants us to have abundant life in every area of our lives. And one of the main places where that abundant life gets robbed is how we think about money. And how we give over to the world's anxiety over money. God wants us to be free to live in joy. Well, we will, at the end of Lent, we have Holy Week. And so on Palm Sunday, we're going to have, during the Sunday school hour, an Easter egg hunt for the children. Every day of Holy Week, that's Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, 5 days. We have breakfast at 7 o'clock in the morning, prayer with a special speaker, and that'll be a great time. We're going to have a great time. We have our speakers lined up. We'll have Trish Bruner was raised in our community, graduated from Marianna High School. She's the pastor at Chipley United Methodist Church, First United Methodist Church. She'll be here. Ron Martin is going to be speaking. Ron Miser, who's the pastor at the St. James AME here in town. Two of our former pastors will be coming, Steve Warren and Dave Barcolo. So that's your lineup. That's pretty good, isn't it? That's a good crowd. I think that we'll be blessed every day. Then Holy Thursday and Good Friday, we'll be sharing those services, both of them at 6 o'clock. What time? 6 o'clock. Holy Thursday, Monday, Thursday, Good Friday, we'll have worship at 6 o'clock, and we'll be combining those services with our brothers and sisters at the Presbyterian Church. So we tried that for the cantata, and it was great. So on Thursday night, we'll be at the Presbyterian Church for Monday, Thursday, the celebration of the Lord's Supper. And when the Lord instituted the Lord's Last Supper. And then Good Friday, we'll be in here. And so we'll have a great time of worship together, preparing for Easter. Easter is going to be, as it is always special, but it is going to be especially special this year, because we'll have our Easter service back in the sanctuary, the newly renovated sanctuary. And the floors got done this week. Anybody see any of the pictures? Look pretty. So it's coming right along. And we are assured that we'll be there by Easter. And we are right on track. Thank you, Paul, for your amazing work and all the others who are working on that great project. There's a lot going on in our church. So you want to jump in as we continue this journey together through this Lenten season to the cross and to the empty tomb of our Lord. As we turn our hearts towards the Lord in prayer, especially want us to remember those who have been hospitalized of our church this past week. Travis Marsh, Trinka Sandifer, Grady Bracken, Betty Duffy, Charlie Brown, and Mark Vickery. We've had a lot of folks sick, but they're all on the mend, so God has been good to help these folks. We want to continue to pray for them all. With these and other concerns, let us turn to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for your goodness to us and your love for us. Your love is a love not only of heart or feeling, your love is a love of action. It's steadfast. You've been faithful and true. When your Son came to share your heart with us, he said to us, "I came to bring you life and life more abundant." Your desire is for us to have peace, to have joy, and to be able to live out of the great well of love that you have born within us. In humility, we confess to you, Holy God, that we have lived in less than your abundance in many ways. We have tried to live life our way, according to our understanding, through our own efforts, our own power. We've tried to compartmentalize our lives, and we've tried to give you parts of our lives, parts of our week, and we have tried to keep others. Deep in our heart, we have trusted ourselves more than we have trusted you. So give us grace, Holy God, not only in this hour of worship that we dedicate to you, but in every hour of every day, to yield entirely to you. To submit all that we are, all that we have, all that we feel, all that is good, all that makes us ashamed, every relationship, every choice, to give everything over to your care. And as we give over our lives to your care, we pray that you would bless us in your way, you said to us, whoever would save his life, whoever would keep his life would lose it. Whoever would give his life for your sake, for the sake of your gospel, would keep it. And so, God, we lay down our lives before you. We place our hopes at your feet. Give us a life that is life. And Father, we pray that you would move in the lives of our congregation who are struggling in body and those within our congregation's circle of care and influence. So many have been sick and facing serious illness. We hand them over to you as you have taught us. We pray for the sick in faith, asking that you would be a healer for them. And God, we also ask you to allow your gospel through us and through your church throughout the world to reach the lost, to allow each person to know the love of Jesus Christ, to find relationship with your Son. We work and we labor and we pray and we teach and we preach and we plan. But God, unless your Spirit moves, unless the Lord builds the house, we who labor in vain. And so, Father, we pray that your Spirit would renew our community and that you would use us for your great task. We ask these things in the name of your Son, our Savior, in whom we find our rest and our hope, and who taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite our children to
come on down this morning. Oh, do I have something wonderful to share with you today. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to introduce you to our new little Miss Marianna. I almost called her Jamie. Miller Brooke Wendt. Yes, and let me tell you, she rocked that stage last night. And she is going to be a wonderful ambassador for the city of Marianna. And not only did she rock that stage last night, she told everybody she came to First United Methodist Church. So, she's going to be a wonderful ambassador for Marianna and the First United Methodist Church. And we're very proud of her. Thank you, Miller Brooke. All right. I want to tell you what happened at school last week. I had this little girl to come up to me. And she said, Miss Nolan, I have an assignment for church. I said, oh, an assignment for church? She said, yes, I've got to find out what your favorite Bible verse is. And I thought, oh, my goodness, let me think. You know, I said, sugar, it's kind of like all these books I read to you. All of them are my favorite. But I guess I like the one that begins, For God so loved the world. And you know, I got to thinking about that. How do we measure God's love? So I brought some things to help me today. I brought a measuring cup today. And we use a measuring cup when we're cooking sometimes. And we measure milk and flour and sugar. And we want to get it just right. So I thought, can we measure God's love with a measuring cup? Because you know what? It says in the Bible that that my cup runneth over. Well, if that cup runneth over, I can't measure that love with that, can I? No. Well, then I thought about a measuring tape, okay? And Lord help us, I hope this doesn't come back and bite me. But this is to measure how wide and how deep and how long something is. And I thought, can we measure God's love by a measuring tape? Because it says in the Bible that God's love is higher than the heavens. Now, I don't think that's going to reach the heavens, do y'all? No, so I don't think we can measure it with that. And then I thought about a watch. A watch measures time. And I bet there's some people out there right now looking at their watches to measure how long that preacher's sermon's going to be today. But then I thought to myself, can we measure that? And the Bible says that God's love is everlasting, from everlasting to everlasting. Now, I don't think my good old Timex can measure that either, you know? And I think about measuring God's love by the verse, For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son so that we would not perish but have everlasting life. And isn't that a wonderful love? It's one we can't measure. Hey, we don't need to measure it. We just need to experience God's love. So the next time you see a measuring cup or a tape measure or a watch, you think about how wonderful God's love is and how much He loves you. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Dear Jesus, we just thank You so much for loving us. We thank You, God, for sending Your Son, Your only Son, so that we can have everlasting life. And all God's children said, Amen.
Of preparation today is, Lord, who throughout these 40 days, which is a prayer for Lent. So it's not one that you know like you know Amazing Grace, but we're going to sing it a few times through Lent, okay? And by the end of Lent, you'll know it. But sing it from the heart. Sing it as a prayer. Please stand. We give You our hearts first and foremost, and we give gifts that are a sign of our love and a response to Your giving to us, Your heart, Your love, and all that we have. Bless these gifts and use them that Your gospel might be proclaimed in all the earth. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Gospel reading is Matthew chapter 4. We'll read from verse 1 through verse 11.
Oh, I'm muted. Let me turn myself back on. There we go. Thank you. Matthew chapter 4, we'll read the first verse through the 11th verse. Listen for God's word. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And he fasted 40 days and 40 nights. And afterwards he became famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." He answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." And then the devil took him to the holy city, placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone." Jesus said to him, "Again it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." And again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." And Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God, serve only him." And then the devil left him. And suddenly, angels came and waited on him. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated, please. As we've been saying for the last several weeks, Lent is a season of turning to God. One of the words that is translated, the Old Testament word, it's translated repent, is shuv. And shuv literally means return. So return from what? And return to what? Well, we are returning to God, and we are returning from sin. We are returning to God, and we are returning from everything else except God. You know, repentance isn't just about the fact that we've been bad. Sometimes we have, but sometimes we've just been distracted. And so Jesus goes into the wilderness, away from every distraction, to focus his heart and his life and his attention on God. The New Testament word for repentance is metanoia. It means a changed mind. Metanoia means to be transformed in our thinking, to become teachable, to recognize where we think that we understand the world and life, and we have gone crazy and don't know it because everyone around us is crazy too. And the Lord is offering us sanity, a new way of thinking rightly and living a life that makes sense, a life that is life, a life that is sustainable, a life that is abundant. Our church does stewardship during the spring. And sometimes people hear stewardship and in their mind they go, click, right? I used to drive a lot. I did 2 graduate degrees in Atlanta and never lived there. So I was in the car a lot. And this was before the era where you could watch television on your cell phone while you were driving. So I did something very old-fashioned. I listened to the radio, and I would listen to National Public Radio back in those days. I listened to the news, because that's the news that you could get on the radio, was National Public Radio. And a few times a year, and they would say, listener-supported National Public Radio, right? You've heard that? And so every now and then, they have to get that listener support. So you know what they do? They do a fun drive. And during that time, I'd say, I can't listen to the news. I can't listen to Kai Rizdahl and all that about the finances. And I can't listen to Science Friday because I've got to just turn this off. I'm not going to listen to all that. And sometimes we do that about the stewardship campaign. we just click, turn it off. Whew, I'm going to the beach this weekend. But I want to say this as we are preparing to begin a stewardship campaign, that churches should never have a fundraising campaign. Stewardship is not a fundraising campaign. We treat it that way because we've been infected by the world. Stewardship is not about fundraising. Right. Stewardship is about recognizing that we are stewards. You know what a steward is? It's a person who takes care of something for somebody else, a manager, right? And so a stewardship campaign is about a time to be trained as disciples who recognize that we own nothing. God owns everything. And so how do we submit to the Lordship of Christ in the way that we faithfully manage everything? Our time, our abilities, our hearts, our relationships, and yes, many times, where the rubber meets the road is our money. Many times churches treat stewardship campaign as a way to get more money. Hey, everybody, we need more money. Give us more money. That is not what a stewardship campaign is supposed to be about. That is theologically irresponsible for churches to talk like that. Listen, money is one tool to proclaim the gospel. It's one tool. And more might be helpful. But if we put our faith in more money, even if we get more money, it would be counterproductive for the proclamation of the gospel. Y'all ever heard a preacher say something like that before? We don't usually say that. I want to say this before we start into stewardship. The only responsible way as Christians to start talking about church finances is to say, God has already given us more than enough. Where's the gospel growing fastest in the world? How many congregations in Africa do you think have a $400,000 budget? And yet, some way, somehow, They're proclaiming the gospel. So when churches poor mouth and, oh, you got to give us more, we're broke. No. Let's start by saying, we already have more than enough. It's not what it's about. The point of a stewardship campaign is not getting your money. God doesn't want your money. You know what God wants? He wants you. He wants your heart. He wants your life. He wants your love. He wants you. And he wants you in order to bless you. Whatever you give to him, he can bless. And whatever you withhold from him is withheld from his hand of blessing. The issue is not about more. I grew up in certain kind of traditions where we thought blessing meant more. You know, I'll give my money to God and he'll bless it and he'll give me more money. Like it was a... That's wrong. That's a lie. That's a lie. That's not what it means. Some people have lots and lots and lots of money and it is a curse to them. And the more money they have, the more cursed they are. Giving our financial lives to God allows the financial area of our life to be blessed, whether we have lots or whether we have nothing. The question of our finances is a question of seeking God's abundant life in every part of our lives. And so, this is a spiritual issue. Money is a spiritual issue. It's a spiritual issue. Jesus didn't talk about anything more than he talked about money. He talked about money more than he talked about anything else. He came proclaiming the kingdom of God, and then he started talking about money. Why? Because whatever has your money is your king. And the kings of this world are hard taskmasters. The kings of this world do not love you. There is one king who loves you eternally. God loves you. God loves you. God loves you, and he came to give you life. And life more abundantly, a rich and a full and a joyful life. The world's way of approaching money, and that's where the rubber meets the road for many of us, the world's way of approaching money is full of death. It's full of anxiety and emptiness. It makes people predators of each other. It teaches us that we are what we buy rather than being beloved and made in the image and likeness of God. I asked this question Wednesday night. What is the number one cause of divorce? Money struggles. Somebody is a smart aleck, I don't know who it was, from the side. I said, what's the number one cause of divorce? I said, marriage. Lent is a time of spiritual cleansing. It's a time where we hold up our wounds to God and we let God heal us. It's a time where we take the empty places of our lives and we let God make us whole. And if we withhold the way that we handle material stuff, the stuff of earth from him, then those are big holes in the places that God can heal us. Lent celebrates these 40 days that our Lord went into the wilderness to be tried, to be tempted. At least two of the three temptations deal directly with how our Lord himself dealt with the pull of material stuff. The devil comes to Jesus and he says, you look hungry, pal. And Jesus is like, I am hungry. And he says, how about make these stones into bread? And Jesus is tempted to find his source in the things of earth rather than in provision that comes from God. In the last temptation, the devil takes him before all the kingdoms of the earth, all the stuff of earth, all the glory of earth, everything that the earth has to offer. And he says, if you'll worship me, you can have it all. You know what worship means? It means worth-ship. Whatever is valuable to you, whatever finds worth to you, that's what you worship. And the question is, Jesus, will you find worth in all this stuff? And Jesus says, my worth comes from God alone. If the Son of God, who is sinless, who is perfect, was tried and tempted in his relationship with the things of this earth, you will be too, and I will be too. We all will be. In every case when the devil is tempting Jesus, he offers him more. Jesus, don't you want a little bit more? Don't you want some more? You look hungry, Jesus. Do you want some more? I think we all, in one way or the other, have this little voice inside of us. And what do we want? We don't want much. We just want a little more. Just a little more. Just a little bit more. And Jesus says to the devil, I have enough. I have enough. That's the temptation that goes back to the garden. How much is enough? A little bit more. God says, I've given you all the trees of the garden, and they're full of fruit, and they're delicious. You can have them all, except for this one. Leave this one alone. And which one do they eat? More. So, let's all search our hearts, be honest with ourselves. When does it become enough? When do we say, you know what? Enough. I have enough. I have enough. I have plenty. when I started ministry, I was first appointed as a 1999, and I earned less than $25,000 a year. It didn't feel like enough. Right? But I didn't want much more than that. We lived in a house that's 1,300 square feet, a little block building out in the country. I was like, this is tight. If it was just a little bigger, if I had just a little more, little more, a little more, how much more? How much more is enough? How much more successful do we have to be before we say, you know what? I'm just on a treadmill here. Enough. I don't need to be any bigger. How much more stuff do we have to have? How many more storage facilities do we have to fill before we say, I've got too much stuff. Enough. I don't need anything more. How much more? You know, I had a professor who said, how many books are enough? One more. How much is enough? How much nicer a car? You know, if your car gets you from here to there, four wheels and a seat, then it serves its purpose. My car has something I haven't seen in a long time. It's got crank windows. Remember that? Maggie Grace got in it. She said, Daddy, what's this? I said, if you push it forward, the window will go down. If you pull it back, It'll go up. She tried it. Oh, I love Daddy's car. She loved it. How nice do the appliances have to be? How many features do they have to have? How many vacations do we need? How much more do we need? Just a little bit more. More. Just a little bit more. And why? It's a sense of dissatisfaction that God has put inside of us. This dissatisfaction that is misdirected, an unholy discontent, and it's a spiritual sickness that robs our joy and keeps us from being able to taste the blessings that he gives us. It's the lie of the devil to Jesus and to you that just a little bit more is going to satisfy me. Just a little bit more is going to satisfy me. And then a little more comes, and what do we want? Just a little more. And no amount of more will ever be enough. Until we replace our unholy discontent with a holy discontent. You were designed to be discontent until you were made holy. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. God in this season is calling us to retrain our hunger. To learn contentment as we strive to know the Lord. God is calling us to learn a heart that says, Father, you've given me more than enough, more than enough, more than enough. Thank you, thank you. You know, it's not some holy thing. It's God's gift to us to learn that we have enough. You know why? Because that's when we can start living in joy. That unholy disconnect that's always crying out for more is the devil's tool to steal from your life. And God wants you to know life and life more abundant. That life is a life of joy, of simplicity, of generosity. It's a life that's free from fear and anxiety, that's free from hunger. And that life is offered to us today. There's a prayer that the writer of our little book, Enough, offers us to pray. It's called the Contentment Prayer. And I'd like everybody to pull out your bulletin. You'll find that in your bulletin. Let's say this together, and let's say it before the Lord. Join me as we pray together, saying, Lord, help me to be grateful for what I have, to remember that I don't need most of what I want, and that joy is found in simplicity and generosity. Let's stand as we proclaim the church's faith. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is the one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our hymn of invitation is My Hope is Built. I invite us all to sing with all of our heart. And if anyone would like to spend some time in prayer, the altar of the Lord is open. Some of you have talked to me about joining the church. If you have an interest in being a part of this fellowship, I invite you to share that with me, and we'll talk about how you can become a part of this body of believers. And also, if anyone in here wants to know how to become a Christian, or you're not sure if you are a Christian, I want you to know you can have assurance in your heart, and please come talk to me. Following the benediction, I'll be at the rear of the facility, and I invite you to come talk to me about any concern you might have. Receive this blessing. Lord, bless your people. Send your grace upon them. Allow them to live in the abundance that you have given your Son that they might have. Go now in peace and joy. Offer the love that you've been given to each person you meet. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.